the first memories I had in 1900 was in Bernardo's house. At that time he was living near Piazza del Popolo, and he called me because he wanted to present to me the script on Last Tango in Paris. He wrote together with Kim Marcalli, great editor, the editor that did The Conformist. And we spoke about Last Tango, he gave me the script. And next to him there was a five script, one top to the other. And he said to me, Vittorio, also, remember that I mentioned to you that I was writing with Kim, also with Giuseppe, my brother? We wrote a big epic project for television, five episodes called 1900. So when you finish to read Last Tango, this package is for you, so you can say, and I say, no, thank you, Bernardo. Don't give me the script now, because I will, even unconsciously, start to have my imagination go into this subject and I doing something not appropriate for Last Tango in Paris. So let me, one at a time, I think no any other cinematographer will refuse to receive a script from the director. But I was very sincere with him, because I knew myself. And even if I start reading the other one, even in a night I'm dreaming and I'm mixing the two stories, so it's better not, I better be concentrated on this one. Originally, 1900 was conceived to be five episodes for Italian television at that time. The story went on, we started to thinking about Last Tango had several problems with the actor. Jean-Louis Trintignant was already busy, Dominique Sanda, which was written for them, was pregnant by a child. He went through different actors, different actresses. Finally arrived to Marlon Brando and Maria Schneider, but Marlon required to postpone the picture 6 months because he had some problem in the family, just finished The Godfather, and Bernardo said, okay, I'm waiting just for him. In fact, when we spoke to Vittorio, I think I need somebody like him, so let's wait. But no problem, I mean, we wait him if I do some other work, but I keep my word that when we start with you, no problem. So time passed by. In 1900, there was in a standby position. And we finished Last Tango. Bernardo was very happy. I remember when we finished the last scene here in Paris on this balcony when Marlo died. He was so happy. He says, I found the ending. Bernardo said, I always had a problem with the ending, to finish inappropriate. But this one, I believe, is fantastic, really fantastic. The picture was a great success. Everybody started to asking to him to do whatever you want to do now, because The Conformist was a fantastic movie, but Last Tango arrived at another even level. And Bernardo said, I want to do 1900. At that time, there was quite a major difference to do a movie for television or for cinema. In a sense, the television was Bernardo did some experience. He did a documentary series about the way of the petrol in Arabia, I think he did. So he knew, no doubt, that his expression have to be in big screen, in cinema. And everybody accepted to do 1900. And so I start to read him. And when we start to spoke, he say, Bernardo, ma, we're doing the entire, every single shot, every single script. Yes, Vittorio, don't worry. Okay, What do you think? What we can do? We start to talk about the visual style of the picture. Once he mentioned to me, well, you know, I would like to follow the nature, la natura, le quattro stagioni, la possibilità di visualizzare la vita di un essere umano attraverso i suoi tempi di vita con le stagioni. So we're going to film in summer when they are a child, in the fall when he's grow up, in the winter the fascist, and in springtime when we have the new completely changing the politics in Italy after the liberation.
Cosa fai adesso?
Sento la voce di mio padre che mi parla.
Donna Varnese.
Processo popolare contro Alfredo Berlinghieri, padrone perciò nemico del popolo.
For us, Ninety Dunder was a kind of a competition of Spider Stratagem, The Conformist, Last Tango. Ninety Dunder was almost the sum of this journey. Spider Stratagem was done in a little town near Parma, which is the original town of Bernardo, called Sabbioneta. And I presented to him the idea to do a very naive look, because when somebody start to coming from a main city like Paris this day, or Rome, any European town, go to in the country, it somehow there is a kind of an opening of the nature with colors, the color of nature, the changing so much during the season, compared to what in the city, most everything is more gray, black, white, neutral, bluish, but there is no an explosion of color. And one way to another, I made 5 years of studying photography in a beautiful school, I have to say. I have a very good memory of the school, La Duca d'Aosta in Italia, a Roma. Io avevo 14 anni, ricordo, dove ho cominciato, no, 12 anni. E mentre studiavo al mattino, lavoravo in un laboratorio fotografico nel pomeriggio. La mia famiglia era povera. My father was a projectionist. He couldn't have the money to support me through the entire study that I need later on. And so I have to work in the afternoon in order to be able to be a student. And so I I finished the 5 years with the diploma of maestro di fotografia. And my father asked to a great cinematographer at the time. He was graduated in engineering, engineer Piero Portalupi. In Italy he was doing, he has a major contract with Luxfilm, the same company my father was working with, to do just movie for Luxfilm. And he did also in, the only thing they did very good was outside the Luxfilm, was Ben-Hur. He mainly lead all the entire, the second unit, the famous running of the with the horses on the circus. That was mainly what he mainly did in that movie. And my father asked, engineer, my son Vittorio just almost finished the school in photography, and you know, he would like to interested in cinema. He coming once in a while with me here next into the Luxfilm. He's watching film, so he's really enchanted by cinema. I would like to start to working. Can you take him as a second or third assistant? E ho ricevuto il più bel no della mia vita. He said no. Sì, Renato, the name of my father. Vittorio studied photography. He's very good. But in order to do cinema, he should start to study cinematography. So send him to the Centro Sperimentale di Cinematografia. As soon as he finished that course, I will take him as an assistant. I arrived at this journey because my preparation was done in kind of school. They was teaching me in black and white. I went to the Centro Sperimentale and they said to me, Mr. Serraro, very good, but you are too young. You are 16, you need to be 18. So in order to keep to be student, I made another film school, not so much important, in order to be continue to be student. And at the same time was again working in the laboratory of doing black and white photography. And finally I went to the Centro Sperimentale and I started to my journey in cinema. Ma at that time even Centro Sperimentale was teaching all the students in black and white. Only in the second years they made very little approach to what could be the feeling of filming color. At that time, don't forget, the people were thinking, if you want to do, you want to shoot in color, it's good if you're doing a comedy, musical, or western. If you want to do dramatic thing, you have to shoot in black and white. Because color, the technician, they were not able to approach how color can be visualized in shadows. And there was a technician, particularly from technical at that time, they were saying the way you're supposed to have the costume in such a different color, the architecture, the set, all particularly the light. So there was a kind of period from the 50 to the 70 mostly, the major film done in color, apart very few examples, they were practically lit in such a uniform way that you don't have any dialogue between light and shadows. It was practically completely annullata la possibilità di un rapporto drammatico tra queste due cose. La mia fortuna è stata che quando mi hanno chiesto di fare il primo film praticamente in colore, prima di Strategia del Ragno, era la società Titanos, perché io avevo fatto Giovinezza con Franco Rossi con loro, mi offrono di fare il Diritto al ciclo del tennis in colore. E io, il film si va a girare in Jugoslavia, because shooting in Yugoslavia, it was less expensive than shooting in Italy. And we were using the system Techniscope, which was, instead to have a 4 perforation, to have a 35 millimeter cinemascope, we were using a system from Technicolor, 2 perforation only, so the film was very small. It was blow up 4 times in order to reach the big screen of cinemascope, ma with the poor quality. Anyhow, being in Yugoslavia, one day I went to visit a little village called Klebine, near Zagabria, and I discovered an incredible world of the primitive painting, the naive painters. And I was shocked because they painting on glass. When you painting, if you're looking at the painting over here, originally it was painted from the back. Oil color on glass are not absorbed by the canvas or by wood. They stay with the complete incredible saturation of color. And watching the painting of Generali, Ivan Generalic, Mio Kovacic, Laskovic, Mecharek, all the painters that I saw in those villages, in the museum, I was mesmerized. Later, when we did with Bernardo's by the stratagem, I met the painting of the naive Italian naive, like Gino Covilli and Antonio Ligabue. So arriving at the 1900, the first part, I said, Bernard, I would like to do in that kind of naive vision, without any electric light. So we have to do the first part completely done in a very natural way, like the primitive, like we did by the stratagem. After, I would like to introduce step by step the artificial light in the second part, and going completely in dramatic way in making the expressionism, the German expressionism, like Otto Dix, the complete separation between light and shadows when the fascist period arriving, and reopening in after the liberation of Italy in 1945 with an explosion of color, and where we can see together the natural and the artificial color. That was the kind of concept. My first teachers in color were the primitive painters, were the naive. Step by step, honestly, I even during last 1900, I knew already the primitive. But when Bernardo was talking to me about other painters, another chance, I used most of my feeling. But honestly, I didn't know the kind of power that the color had symbolically. The kind of power that they had according to the physiology of color, the kind of power they can have the dramaturgy of color. But I went by instinct. And Bernardo, he did a lot of psychoanalysis, Bernardo, before I met him. So for him, using the elements in a symbolic way was very important for him. And done all this operation, particularly when I arrived at Apocalypse, now soon after the 1900, again I was using the conflict between artificial color on top to national color, creating this conflict between two different cultures, two different companies, society. And I started to realize that, yes, I was using without knowing the reason. And after Apocalypse, now I have to stop filming. I refuse. I remember they called me in Paris to do a movie, and I realized that I was proposing to the director old idea. I don't have any new idea. Apocalypse Now was too much for me. It was taking me so at an incredible level that any other level was not appropriate. Plus, I felt that they don't have a new idea because I was exhausted. My energy was out. I need to generate myself. I stopped for 1 year in the house and study color, and after I realized mentally illogical in the way that I can use the color as I use it. It's very strange. I came in Paris to do conformist, and I was enchanted by the incredible natural color at the end of the day, a magic hour. They were so strongly bluish compared to artificial light. And I pushed Bernardo to do the entire shooting in Paris in a symbolic way, using this color without knowing the knowledge or the meaning of that kind of color. And Bernardo said, Vittorio, I love it. I think it's fantastic. Let's do it. When we come back for Last Tango, I used the opposite way. I pushed more the artificial light compared to the natural white. And because Paris in winter, like today, has a very dark light with cloudy, so the city is lit all over, and so it gave me this feeling of orange. I brought it in on the screen, but I felt that I need to know the symbolic. So only after Apocalypse Now, that I stopped for 1 year, and I study exactly the meaning of the color, I was able to continue the journey in a conscious way with Bernardo in La Luna. That was done completely with the symbolic way. Rewatching, for example, I am going to be in Bologna, at the Cineteca Bologna, watching the last transfer that they did. They made the last, let's say, reprinted according to one of the last transfers that I did years before. So by the practically the Blu-ray they will be in that package done by Bologna. Now I'm going to supervise before they put in DVD. So I'm glad that I can close the circle, always supervising by myself, because once you propose an idea to the director, it's been approved, I'm the one that are responsible into the laboratory to print, to transfer, to retransfer, to reprint, and so on and so on and so on. And usually after Bernardo watching what we did, they give me the approval. Thanks to the success of Last Tango, give it to Bernardo the chance to film it in order, practically, every single period of the picture. And so we had, because we also have to have a deal with the time that they were harvest the il grano, when they were planting the grano, when they were, the new machine was arriving into the worker in that period, how changing the relationship between the land workers and the il padrone, the kind of man. So practically it was a life journey, was not a film journey. I always thought that any project that we do, even this interview that we're doing now for the film, represent your moment of your life. Not that you can recognize yourself when you did something, you were in that way. I am here now, this is me, in this moment. Any movie represents our period of life in that moment. It through our expression, our creativity, our experience. In reality, it doesn't matter which kind of profession we do. We try to understand who we are. We try to answer to some personal questions. We try to understand the meaning of our life. 1900 gave it to us even more, the standard film, the chance to rethinking, for example, for the first part of the children. When we were child, my father was taking myself, my son, my brothers, and my young sister in the country of Siena, where our uncle was living, and we have all the summer time into the nature. So all the experience that I had when I was 5, 7, 10 years old come back when we were doing 1900, because it reminded to me the kind of living that I had when I was a child. What happened to me that if the decision was to taking the chance not to use any artificial light, I had the gaffer and the K-grip to build some major big 4x4 meter frames where I put in different material. Once was black when I won, because I was using the concept that the light is matter practically. You can also make a sculpture with light if you want to. So if this too light, in my opinion, was too much, I was having to, I can put the black over here and see the how was defined with only one light, or vice versa. Or if I need to bounce one light to another, I can change the material in this frame. I can use black, white material to bounce. Or I can use a reflector, so I have an even much stronger one. So practically I was trying to the entire segment of the picture using only natural light and try to working in adding or subtracting light according to the meaning. The second part, we try to use light. At that time, the technology didn't allow me to do anything else. They just having very big dimmer. resistance and having one electrician for each dimmer. So if I want to do some kind of light change, like in particularly when you move it from summer, when you have a very strong, long time of similar light, when you go in the fall, you can have a wind. So the wind having a cloud going from to the sun and moving. So this movement of the universe, in way we live in, according to the season as well, I would like to transfer in the image. The only way to do it was to have the chance to put lights under a dimmer. So in some time I was able to electrician to make in queue with them or the entire generator going down on voltage, so everything become very soft, and after maybe coming back and so on. So I was, for the first time, I was trying to use a kind of dialogue between these two energy, not in conflict, but in the kind of dialogue between the two of them. And particularly when I arrived at the third part in the fascist time, I almost stopped completely the natural light and using only the artificial mainly. The artificial will allow me to make shadows in order to have this kind of conflict between the way of living in the country in an appropriate way and the way in one time it was the fascist spread arriving and dictating the way of living in a completely different way. And only at the end of the picture I was able to reopen again the two different energy. Practically I was using those two main elements that I have. My language is a visual language. Like the writers is using his own word to describing the characters, describing the situation, I was able to have these two main elements, the sun journey and the moon journey, and so light and night, day and night, or light and shadows, artificial or natural. Those kind of vocabulary, was, even if it was very specific, but very elementary. The only reference the sometimes Bernardo was using was Gone with the Wind. Was saying in relation to another movie that was taking the scale, the dimension, the story-wise, the epic, a drama at the same time of the history of one specific period in America. No doubt that there is a producer in America, Mike Medavoy, that wrote a book that says, "You are as good as your last one." Usually people take in, visualize your level in a film industry according to your last success or not success. Well, we had before Last Tango in Paris. And so Bernardo at that time had the chance to do whatever he could do, and that was a great luxury that I don't know this today can be done any longer. And I have to say that I'm very lucky because I was able to meet a great director. I didn't work with many directors because I don't think that a cinematographer can do every movie, can work with every director, can do every story. But between Bernardo Bertolucci, Francis Coppola, Warren Beatty, Carlos Saura, and recently Woody Allen, I was able to be in, è come ricevere un contagio. Ogni regista, c'è un momento della sua vita in cui fare un film non è più solo fare un film, ma realizzare un sogno. There is a dream that start to go in mind of some every director, everyone. They can become the symbol of the entire life. Everybody says, l'usignolo canta sempre la stessa canzone. The bird, always singing the same kind of a tone. noi, ogni artista fa sempre un'opera. Federico Fellini, Bernardo Bertolucci, Woody Allen, praticamente the team, the concert, the main concert is only only one. Well, I was lucky that I met those kind of people in this specific moment. 1900 became one of the great dream of Bernardo to do that. Usually with Bernardo, since we started with Spade Stratagem, we were in such a great agreement, there was no any discussion or anything. No doubt that the chance, once we spoke at the beginning, to being free to elaborate in anything was absolutely with Bernardo. There is one episode that that did happen during the first part of the summertime with the children. That was an episode when the father of Alfredo was searching for his own son that went to next to Olmo. It's night. I said to Bernardo, because I don't like to use the artificial light in this episode, because I don't think it is appropriate to use a 10 kilowatt, give me the vision that can become artificial in this part. Without the entire part that can be so natural, it's like we did in Apocalypse, in a Spider Stratagem. It would be great if you can film it at dusk time. And he said to me, well, Vittorio, it's different. Spider Stratagem, we had 12 people together with the crew. We were able to do anything we want. Here is a big crew, it's a big company, it's big expenses on. So I have to shoot the entire day or entire night. So I said to him, okay, let me try to shoot at daytime, and I'm using some filter in order that we don't stop the production for the entire day, but we can have the similar effect. And Bernardo called me to say, because there was one particular camera movement, till that we were in the high level, but the moment when we have to pan up to the, c'era un carro di fieno dove Olmo e Alfredo stavano dall'alto, erano contro il cielo. So there was a kind of backlight, back sky, let's say. And when we were panning up there, you can tell that the sky was not nice sky. So he said to me, Vittorio, don't work, because we see these, the sequence is made at daytime, and not at night time, like that. And I said, well, Bernardo, I don't know if we can change the angle, whatever, but I don't want to use artificial light. And we had a very serious discussion, till that I said, I'm going away, Bernardo. You call another somebody else. And that was the most difficult moment in my life, probably, to say I don't continue the journey with you, because you push me to do something that I don't want to, in an area that I don't want to go. Till, and also I was offended that they call also the production manager to be at this discussion. So for production was a problem. So at one point he said to me, okay, let's leap over. Stop the discussion tomorrow. I have to say that 1 hour later, no more than that, he called me on the telephone. I say, ma Vittorio, don't you remember for maybe, you lived some time or in other moments of your life or whatever, when in the summertime in the country, after dinner, in summertime, people used not to go to sleep. They were using the courtyard and having a chat. And the children were playing and they were chat. And they would open a little fire. And maybe they have a lantern light around. Why we cannot rebuild such atmosphere of the fact that they can have the pedal light over there, the lantern or the little fire, so on. I remember when I was a child in Siena, and that's what happened to me, that every evening when we doing the after the dinner, we would play with my brothers and the other children, around the older people that were playing like that. And I visualized the fact that that was the reason that I can use artificial light, but was created by fire or by oil lantern, and because the meeting was creating kind of a different perspective, we didn't have the clear mind to think. At that moment Bernardo was fantastic.
Una volta l'ho sentito in fondo un pozzo che mi chiamava.
Alfredo!
Vai, scappiamo di casa tutti e due.
The most difficult shot was a very dangerous one. Now that you remind, now that I reminded the scene during the children period, there was a sequence when Olmo and Alfredo, the two little boys, they were doing a kind of play, very dangerous. They were laid down in the middle of the track of the train, and they're showing them who has the courage not to leave when the train arriving. In fact, of the first period we see when they were a child, the Alfredo was scared at one moment, jump out, and Olmo was able to stay under the train. And the shot was very complicated because we have a big crane. We have the Chapman with a long arm, and it was on one side, and we were able to stay right on top of the camera over here, of the two children. We did the rehearsal without the train, the two of them. We were supposed to start to see the train over there. Alfredo, one of the child, leave. We see almost stay, and we're going up with the crane over here. So we see the child at the train arriving. No, for a moment we were going, sorry, for a moment we were going up to see the train. So they have a chance to remove the real child and put the dummy. And when the train arriving and we go down, we see the train passing over the dummy.
Sei scemo? Vediamo chi ha coraggio e chi ha paura.
Quando il treno ci passa sopra chiudi gli occhi o diventi cieco.
When the crane went back over here, there was an electric a telegraph pole next to the track, and the camera stopped on the pole. It cannot move it. And I remember that when he stopped, I saw the camera shaking. I was looking up, and I was nearby, and I said, Alfredo, they're going to try to unlock the camera, and the train was arriving. And Bernardo, when he saw the camera, tried to give the alarm of the train stopping, and finally Alfredo put himself over the back of the crane, so the crane finally remove like he was supposed to do normally, because it was too low compared to the train arriving. Was supposed to move over there, finally moved and the train passed. And everybody was so shocked, and thanks God everything went well, nothing happened. Bernardo was looking at me, of course we don't do another take. No!
Adesso non scappi più!
Lasciami andare!
Vigliacco! Olmo! Olmo!
I was lucky that during my life I was once educated in a photography school and seen a film school. I was educated in mainly the relationship between darkness and light, black and white mainly, and later I discovered color through primitive painting before to arrive into classic painting. And discovering Caravaggio, that gave me an incredible shock in the way that you can use the color and the light as a symbolic way. And when I saw Leonardo with his perfect balance in The Last Supper, I realized that also the visual world of cinema can be in state to have so many different numbers. The film started at 1 to 133, the French panoramic went to 1 to 166, and the English went to 185, and the 65 millimeter is 1 to 21, and the anamorphic is 1 to 41, the new television is 1 to 78, is a jungle of number. Leonardo said 2 to 1, perfect, like two square. I was also lucky that I was growing in a photography studio at the beginning, into film studio, knowing my learning when I was a child, the chemistry, so I knew all the photochemical version, and I done most of my lifetime in cinema through the different technology, even innovation in technology in cinema. And at one point I had the chance to, when Francis Coppola asked me to use electronic cinema in One from the Heart, I refused it because I thought there was no ready in a technologic way. But we have to keep the main master, that was the film. But later I had the chance to test the first high definition video system by Sony, doing a short film for the Italian Rai Television. They were very intelligent at the time, testing new instrument, and we did with Giuliano Montaldo, Arlecchino in Venice. Later, when I was teaching at the Academy of Image in L'Aquila, Sony gave me the new Cine Alta to test, and I was having the student using in doing their own test with my supervision, and with Carlo Saura doing Flamenco Flamenco, che there was not just for theatrical release, ma done in studio, which was a lot of light control by myself, that I can use the first digital system, really. And Woody Allen called me for Café Society. I said to Woody, Woody, I couldn't print the last movie that I did in Rome because Technicolor closed the laboratory. If today I want to do another movie, we don't have Kodak any longer. We have to reserve a specific number of films today, much in advance. They should come wherever you are, and we don't know where to develop. So why we are running behind the system that is fading in front of us? I know enough today, and I know a very good camera that can give it to us. I think the quality that we used to. Why we don't jump together into the digital world in order that we can do our best to use it and probably even make some kind of a new push in the direction that we want to, and not having someone else doing after we have to use it anyhow. And no doubt, I think we take a good choice, because technology today, the digital world is a very good level. It's not absolutely true that recording image in digital is very superficial. It doesn't have thickness, or doesn't have a depth, let's say, compared to photochemical. Because anyhow, wherever you're filming in 16, or in anamorphic, in a Technoscope, or CinemaScope, or 65, whatever, in photochemical, after you have to go to a digital intermediate, so you go to digital anyhow, and the maximum that you can record in digital today, what I used to do with the Sony F65 in the three films that I did with Woody Allen, which is 4K, which means the kind of information that I can have in definition, 16-bit colors. Then nobody talk about bit color usually. 16-bit color that I can record in a in the file are very close, similar to film, no doubt. But anything doesn't matter if you capture in film or digital, after you go in digital intermediate. Today, digital intermediate in any laboratory in the world can be done maximum 4K, but 12-bit color. Later, the distribution arrived, the general distribution is 2K at 10 bits. Very rarely, some theater show 4K at 12 bit. To give you two number, 16-bit color means 200 billion of color shade. 12-bit color is only 16 million. Where are the other 199 billion of color shade? Doesn't matter if you record in film or in digital. When we were at Cannes Festival, I spoke with the president of the Commission Superior Technique, Scott Glenn, and I said, Scott, but I record 16-bit color, can you screen? I said, no, there is no any projector that can screen at that level. I hope next year I can convince to change the technology. So practically all the energy, the people in good faith, but very romantic way as well, thinking, oh, film is, oh, the smell of film is great, fantastic, whatever. The energy that's been spent over there, the anyhow, there is no one screening in the world that can screen film only in special occasion, probably one night, that's all. I can prove it there. The most of the element in recording is really question of light. How to use the light? Because today most of the director, cinematographer, producer, whatever, any digital camera is so sensitive. We talk about 1,000 ASA is the Sony F65. 1,200 the Sony 55. You can record an image, doesn't matter what, in any location, any available light. But that available light is correct for that specific scene, in that specific period, with that specific drama? I don't know. I don't think so. So that's the most idea that we have to concentrate in. How we can lit or framing the proper images that make the difference. Not because it's a digital or photochemical. Why we don't put the energy all together and raise the industry to screen exactly what we record? Because why we record 200 billion color shade and we cannot show to an audience all around the world? That's the most important thing that we're supposed to fight together. We don't have a system how photochemical had silver master separation in digital. There is no one element that is archivable. People thinking from distributor, producer, director, cinematographer, I done the digital, so it's okay. No, it's the worst. Digital doesn't last 5 years. Because digital doesn't mean permanent. It's only numeric information. If it's not also optical, it's not permanent at all. And today nobody talk about this one. Not even in France, I think, exists a laboratory any longer to do silver master separation. In Italy, we were able to put together when I did the full filmography of Bertolucci. Now, Technicolor disappeared. Not, it doesn't know anymore. Two elements. Raise the level of the film industry so the audience can be respected of what we recorded, forget if he's shooting in 60mm in film, how great it can be. Yeah, but it's past. Let's be honest with today, present, and thinking of present and future, how we can present the best quality we can record to the audience, and how we can preserve for our grandchildren the film. Nobody thinking about these kind of things. Please, let's get together. And let's try to present to audience what we really do. Second, let's to preserve for our grand-grandchildren everything we do today and everything we have in every cinema, cinematheque in the world. Thank you.